Welcome to the first video in our course. In this video, we are going to cover the basic elements of an election. So the idea is we're going to have a vote on some sort of measure that we're wanting to talk about. It might be, we might have candidates, we might have a choice, but overall we have some voters. Those are people who are allowed to cast a vote. We have some sort of candidates or a choice. So we might be choosing between people, or we might call it a choice if we're choosing between non-humans. So something like options for deadlines or houses or office hour choices or cars or whatever. A ballot is when a vote is cast and recorded. We call that a ballot. A preference ballot is something you might not have heard of before. A preference ballot means you list all of your candidates in the order from highest to lowest, rather than just giving your top choice. So we're used to just having a ballot where we choose one or maybe more than one of some choices in most of our elections today. But this preference ballot gives us more information, and it's going to allow us to come up with some different options for ways to calculate who won, and we're going to talk about those ways in future ballots, or in future sections, sorry, not future ballots, in future sections. And we need all the information from a preference ballot in order to do that. A preference schedule is just the book's term for writing down all the voters' preference in one commonly grouped table of information. Here's our first example. The Demublican Party, a made-up party obviously, is holding its annual election. The 1,500 voting delegates are choosing between three platforms: the liberal platform, the conservative platform, or a moderate platform. 17% of the voting delegates prefer L to M and M to C. 32% of the delegates like C the most and L the least. The rest of the delegates like M the most and C the least. So we're supposed to write out the preference schedule first. Okay, so we're going to write the first, second, and third choices. The first is L is like the most to M and M to C. That's 17%. So we calculate 17% of 1,500 and we get 255 voters. It's important that we don't put percentages in here. We always want the number of voters here rather than percentages if we can help it. And next, C the most and L the least, that leaves M in the middle. That's 32%, which we can calculate as 480. The rest, so we take 1,500 minus what we have so far, and that's 765. And I did those numbers beforehand. No, I can't do that fast in my head. That'd be crazy. Okay, like M the most and C the least, that leaves L in the middle. Which candidate has the most first place votes? So if I just look here, the most first place votes is M. Which candidate has the least last place votes? So in here, notice you might automatically say, well, L has the least because it has 480, but look, M is missing. M has no last place votes, so it's actually M has the least last place votes. And in fact, M not only has the most, it has the majority. So the majority is defined as more than half of the votes. If half works out to be exactly a number, it's half plus one. But it's more than half of the votes, so M has the majority here. Our second example has the preference schedule already given to us, and it has a couple questions. So first is, how many voters are there total? So we add up all of the number of voters, 47 plus 36 plus 24 plus 13 plus 5. And I got 125. B, how many first place votes are needed for a majority? So we take half and then round up. So we get 63 are needed for a majority. C, which candidate has the most first place votes? So A has 47, B has 36 plus 5, so that's 41. C has 13, D has 24, and E has none. So A has the most with 47. But do they have a majority? No majority. They didn't reach the 63. Okay, so one of the ideas that's inherent inside of this is the idea of transitivity. Transitivity is that you prefer candidate A over B and B over C. It means you would prefer A over C. So, for example, in this one, 47% prefer A over C, C over B, B over E, E over D. So that means they prefer A over B, for example. So the transitivity is that if A is first, then A actually is above the others, and C they prefer over, say, E or D. C is preferred over D. So making this assumption is important so that we understand what's happening inside of these preference ballots. If we removed a candidate from an election, we could redo the preference schedule with this idea of transitivity. We're going to talk more about this in future sections, but let's look at an example where we do this. So let's look back at this example and say that since no majority was reached, we're going to eliminate all candidates with 20% or less of the first place votes and recount the votes. So, who is eliminated? Well, 20% turns out to be 25, so that means C, D, and E are eliminated. So we want the new preference schedule. So the options are going to be, you prefer A over B or B over A. So who's in what category? All right, let's look at A over B. So these 47 prefer A over B, and these 13 prefer A over B. So that's a total of 60. The rest of the people, the 36, 24, and 5, prefer B over A. So that's 65. So C, which candidate is the majority winner after the recount? B is. B is has the most first place votes, and it has a majority. Remember, we needed 63 for a majority. It has 65, so it has a majority. Okay, so in future sections, we're going to talk about different ways to calculate the vote. Right now, we're just strictly talking about how to set up a preference schedule, how to interpret elections, how to understand how many voters there are, and how they're preferring things, and how to remove a candidate.